We have good reasons to believe that God exists based on the creation of the universe. We have good reasons to believe that God exists based on the fine-tuning of the universe to permit our existence, and the best explanation is design. And we've got good reasons that God is a truth and not a fairy tale, because the Quran can only be best explained by God, because the statements it makes with regards to history and the statements it makes with regards to embryology cannot be explained naturalistically, so they're an indication to the divine, the supernatural.
Science can explain the world better without God than with God. The belief in God is the belief in a concept that doesn't hold water, it is inconsistent. Furthermore, the belief in such an inconsistent concept leads to evil things and should be avoided. Thank you very much.
IslamNet, in collaboration with the Big Debates, are pleased to announce to you that we have, for the first time in the history of Norway, arranged a debate between a Muslim perspective and a non-Muslim perspective on the position of, does God exist? I will start by giving a brief presentation of our organization that is hosting the event, IslamNet. IslamNet is a voluntary organization focusing on promoting dialogue, clearing up misconceptions about Islam, and building bridges between the religious diversity. Our organization was established in 2008, and since then, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have achieved great success, alhamdulillah. We have various activities. Every week we have a da'wah course, a course for Muslims where they can learn about the religion, become more practicing, and get engaged in da'wah and get engaged in the society. We have a weekly information stall about Islam on Karl Johans gate, the main street of Oslo, or Grønland, and this weekend we had it on Jungstorget outside the World Humanist Congress, where we give out free literature and DVDs, books, audio CDs, and whatever people want, and engages in dialogue and discussions with people who are interested in learning about Islam, or they just want to talk about Islam, or just see how Muslims are. We have a course for new Muslims where they get proper education about Islam. IslamNet has four branches, one in Oslo, one in Akershus, in Bodø and Tromsø, and inshallah soon we will be launching in Drammen as well. The aim of our organization is that the information about Islam should be available for everybody in this country. We do not want to convert people to Islam, but we want to present the message of Islam, and if they like it, they are welcome to embrace it. The purpose of this debate. A great number of human beings throughout history have believed in a higher power. But in the modern Western world, you would think that the belief in God has almost died out. So we think it is appropriate to have an open debate on such an important question. Does God exist? God, fairy tale, or truth? Because if God do exist, then that will change your lives. You will have a source where you will deduce the moral values in your life. You would know the purpose of your life. And if God do not exist, then you do not have this source, and you will make your decisions of right and wrong according to subjective opinions among human beings. That is why we think it is very important to have a debate about this great topic. The format for the debate: first, Hamza Tzortzis will be presenting his arguments for the existence of God in 35 minutes. Then Dr. Lars Gule will be presenting his arguments for the not existence of God in 35 minutes. Then Hamza will have 10 minutes to refute Lars Gule's arguments. And then Lars Gule will have 10 minutes to refute Hamza's arguments. And after that, we will have 45 minutes of questions and answers, where you ask the questions. One question at a time will go to Hamza, and the next question will go to Lars. And they will have a maximum of 5 minutes to answer that specific question. After that, Lars Gule will have 10 minutes for the final rebuttal, and Hamza 10 minutes for his final rebuttal. Without any further ado, I would request Brother Zishan to come to the stage to introduce Dr. Lars Gule and Hamza Tzortzis. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I will start by introducing Dr. Lars Gule. Lars Gule was born in the year of 1955, and he is a Norwegian famous philosopher. He is regarded as a scholar of the Middle East, and he took his doctorate degree at the University of Bergen back in 2003 on the thesis Social Development and Political Progress in Two Societies. From the year of 2006, he has been employed at the Oslo University College, currently as a postdoctorate research fellow. And he has also been the Secretary General for the Norwegian Humanist Association from the years of 2000 to 2005. Lars Gule is particularly interested in the topics concerning multicultural society, Islam, human rights, and the Middle East. Dr. Gule has participated in many debates, even on the internet and through media channels, and also in live debates with other people, such as Christians. He is particularly critical of what he thinks is, of what he regards as totalitarian ideologies and religions. He has also appeared in several media stations, both national and international, such as the BBC and the CNN. I will now introduce Hamza Tzortzis. Hamza Tzortzis was born in UK, London, in the year of 1980. He is of Greek origin. His parents migrated to the country of Britain, and that's the place where he grew up. And he himself accepted Islam in the year of 2002. He is currently a public speaker, an international public speaker on Islam, and also a writer as well, with articles, essays, and commentaries on political philosophy, the philosophy of religion and society. Hamza is also a researcher with a recent publication on non-Muslim perspectives on Islam and Muslims. Hamza has participated in many debates and symposiums with leading intellectuals, public speakers, debaters, and academics on the topics regarding Islamic and Western philosophy, politics, and current events. For example, he participated in a debate with the president of the American Atheists, Dr. Ed Buckner, on the topic Islam or Atheism. He also engaged in a debate with the editor of the Philosophy Now magazine, Rick Lewis, on the topic God, Delusion, or Truth. Hamza regularly appears in the media to explain and demystify Islam and provide unique perspectives on current affairs. Hamza has appeared on the BBC, Press TV, Asian Network, Nile TV, Islam Channel, Ummah TV, Iqra TV, and many other international media stations in the world. Without any further ado, please welcome Hamza Tzortzis to begin the debate.
In alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah amma ba'd. Brothers, sisters, and friends, I greet you with the warmest Islamic greetings of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Which basically means, may the peace and blessings of Almighty God, Almighty Allah, be upon you all. Today's debate is a very important debate, brothers, sisters, and friends, because I would argue in the absence of God, there is no ultimate meaning in our lives. There may be meaning in our lives, but there is no ultimate meaning. If our ends are just the same and we pass out of existence, what meaning does that really give? If we're going to end in the grave as worm meat, worm buffet, does it even matter that we existed? This is why the philosopher, Western philosopher, Arthur Schopenhauer, he said, I don't want the universe to exist. I didn't want it to exist, because he had this existential anxiety, this internal anxiety that the people of Norway, unfortunately, are suffering. 20 to 40% of people of Norway are taking antidepressant tablets. It's a fake type of happiness. Money has not worked. Also, in absence of God, there is no ultimate value. If I lived my life as a devil, and Dr. Gule lived his life as an angel, what difference does it make? We're still going to be dust. There's no ultimate value. Also, without God, there are no objective morals. We can't say this is 100% right and this is 100% wrong, because there is no foundation for morality. It's just social pressure, which makes it subjective and relative. This is why it's a very important debate. And in order to argue that God is a truth and not a fairy tale, I will use the following arguments. One, the creation of the cosmos, the creation of the universe. Number two, the design of the universe. And number three, the miracle of the Quran, the miracle of the book of the Muslims. Now let's go to the first argument. Argument number one, the argument from the creation of the universe. Now, brothers, sisters, and friends, we have all asked the same questions. Where did the universe come from? Why does something exist rather than nothing? Now, since the universe had a beginning in time, for instance, according to modern cosmologists, the universe had a beginning at the Big Bang, also known as the hot standard model. As John Boslow, the author of Stephen Hawking's Universe, states, the biggest misunderstanding about the Big Bang is that it began as a lump of matter somewhere in the void of space. It was not just matter that was created during the Big Bang. It was space and time that were created. So in the sense that time had a beginning, space also has a beginning. So in this light, there are only three possible explanations for the existence of the universe. Number one, the universe came out of nothing. Number two, the universe created itself. Number three, or the universe has a creator or a cause. Now, let's take the first one into consideration, brothers, sisters, and friends. We know the universe couldn't have come out of nothing, because out of nothing, nothing comes. This is why P.J. Zwart, in his publication About Time, states, if there is anything we can find inconceivable, is that it is something could arise from nothing. Also, we know that the universe couldn't have created itself, because that would imply a paradox. Can your mother give birth to herself? Can this whole auditorium create itself? Can I exist and not exist at the same time? Can the doctor exist and not exist at the same time? This is a paradox, a logical impossibility. Things cannot exist and not exist at the same time. This is why you cannot have self-creation. Therefore, the best explanation, brothers, sisters, and friends, is that the universe has a creator or has a cause. But all we know from this argument is that there's a cause or there's a creator. We can't claim it's Allah, we can't claim it's Buddha, we can't claim it's Jesus, we can't claim any of the terms we have used, approximately 3,800 names for God since 6,000 BC Sumeria. We've differed about God. God knows. That was supposed to be a joke. Please laugh. That's good. The joke's on me then. So, but if we use our reasoning, as the Quran says, the book of the Muslims, to use our minds, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ, do you not use your minds? We will come to the conclusion that this cause is in line with the Islamic narrative of God. For instance, since this cause created the universe, which includes time and space, it must be one. Because if we claim it's two, if we claim it's three, if we claim it's 300, if we claim it's 3,000, it creates far more questions than it answers. So the simplest explanation is the best explanation. This is a principle in philosophy called Occam's razor, which really means do not multiply entities beyond necessity, because you'll have a huge task of trying to answer more questions than you've answered. Also, it must be uncaused, because there is an absurdity of an infinite regress. Big words, I know. What does this really mean? Say, for example, I wanted to give Dr. Lars Gule a kiss on the cheek. That's another joke. So imagine I want to give him a kiss on the cheek, but I had to ask his wife for permission. And she says, you know what? I can't give you permission because the person behind me has to give me permission. And the person behind that person has to give that person permission. If that went on forever, will I ever give him a kiss? Unfortunately not. So this is the same case with the universe. The creator must be uncreated. The cause for the universe must be uncaused. Also, this creator, this cause must be immaterial, which basically means outside of the universe, outside of the material world. As the Quran says, "Laysa kimithlihi shay." There is nothing like unto him. And the reason for this is because since this creator created space and time, and within space and time is the sum of all material, then it must be outside of space and time, which means it's outside of everything that's material. Most significantly, brothers, sisters, and friends, and this is very important, this creator, this cause must have a will. So it must be able to have a personal relationship with conscious beings in the universe. There's many reasons for this that I'm going to articulate during the rebuttal or during the question and answers, but let me give you some points to consider. The reason this creator cause must be personal, because if it's eternal and uncaused, and it brought into existence an effect that began, it must have chose the universe to come into existence. And choice indicates a will, and a will indicates it can interact with conscious beings. This is very profound, because if you claim this cause is just mechanical, then all mechanical causes exist with their effect. But if this cause is eternal and brought into being the universe at a certain point, therefore it chose for the universe to come into existence. Another argument is, put your right hand up. That's proof that an immaterial cause can bring something into existence. Our minds are immaterial. So, this is in line with what the Quran says in the 112th chapter. The Quran says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدُ اللَّهُ السَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِيدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. As the Quran says, say, He is God, the One, the Unique, the Absolute, God the Eternal. He begets not, nor was He begotten, and there is nothing like Him. So we have good reasons to believe that God exists. Let me give you the second argument, which is God makes sense of the fine-tuning the design of the universe. Now, brothers, sisters, and friends, how do we explain the order of the universe? How do we explain the apparent fine-tuning in the cosmos to permit our existence? Now, to claim that they exist without any purpose is very absurd. For instance, Professor Roger Penrose, he states, there is a certain sense in which I would say the universe has a purpose. It's not there just somehow by chance. And you know what, brothers, sisters, and friends? I think I would agree with the professor, and many of you would agree with the professor. It's more intuitive. It's more in line with our nature, as the Muslims call fitra, meaning the thing that God created within us to acknowledge His existence. Now, the reason I say this is because the existence of our life in this universe depends on a conspiracy. Yes. A conspiracy of initial conditions and constants that must have been fine-tuned to a degree that is incomprehensible. Incomprehensible. Your mind is reeling. Let me give you some of these examples. Example number one, the expansion rate of the universe. According to cosmologists, the universe is expanding, and the Quran substantiates this claim. Now, if the expansion rate of the universe differed by more than 10 to the power of minus 18 seconds, the universe would have recollapsed upon its sides. This is why Stephen Hawking, in his brief history of time, he agrees with this and says the following words. If the rate of expansion 1 second after the Big Bang had been smaller by even one part in 100,000,000,000,000, the universe would have recollapsed before it reaches present size. Let's take another example. It's about low entropy. Professor Roger Penrose of Oxford University in England, he states, in order to produce a universe resembling the one at which we live, the creator would have to aim for a very small volume of the phase space of possible universes. I'm lost. I'm not an academic scientist, so I don't know what he's talking about. But I'm going to ask the question, how small is this volume? And this volume is 1 over 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 123. It's a huge number. There's more zeros in this number than there is protons, electrons, and atoms in the whole universe. Also, let me give you a practical example. This number is equivalent if I was a dartsman. I was holding a dart, and I had to hit the center of the smallest thing, say a proton. Say the center of an atom even. And the dartboard was the entire universe. So I have to be very, 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 very far away to even try and hit the dart or hit the target. And they would have to expect me to hit the center of a proton if the whole dartboard was the entire universe. This is an absurdity. This is an impossibility. The other example is the ratio of the electromagnetic force to the force of gravity. Now, this measures the strength of the electric forces that hold atoms together divided by the force of gravity between them. Now, if these were slightly smaller than its observed value, then only a short-lived miniature universe could exist. No creatures could grow larger than an insect. And that is the reality of this type of fine-tuning. So, in light of this, there are three possible explanations. It's just there. This fine-tuning, this design of the universe is just there. It's physical necessity. The other explanation is chance. And this is the atheist mantra. It's chance. They hold this claim religiously. That was another joke. Get it? The atheists hold this claim religiously. Anyway, the final point is it could be designed. So let's work through these together. Well, first and foremost, it couldn't be physical necessity because these values, these constants, this fine-tuning is not dependent on the laws of nature. It's not dependent on the laws of nature. Also, it would have us to believe that a universe that couldn't allow life could never exist. But we know this is not the case. As scientist Paul Davies, he says, it seems then that the physical universe does not have to be the way it is. It could have been otherwise. So we know physical necessity is not an option as an explanation. What about chance? Well, the chances for the initial conditions for the universe to allow our existence are so unlikely that it would be impossible to use this argument as a rational justification for the existence of the universe that has fine-tuning. But wait 1 second. Mr. Atheist would say, but there's still a chance. Well, would we say such a thing if we found an aeroplane in your front garden overnight? Or for instance, you saw an elephant in your driveway in the morning. Would you say it's just chance? What if, for example, I say that my mother's not really my mother? Because chance, you can claim anything, right? This is why chance, you can't have a discussion. It's counter-discussion. I could claim my mother's not my mother, that she's really a green crocodile that was born on Pluto and flew here on a pint of milk. You might think I'm crazy. Well, I might say to you, but there's still a chance. This is the absurdity of the chance hypothesis. But also, it's not just about chance. Because if you think about it, it's something called specified probability. You have a probability, but it has to conform to an independent pattern. Let me give an example. Say I'm a monkey, okay? Or a gorilla. More gorilla than a monkey, I know. Say I was a gorilla typing away on a typewriter for 24 hours. And then you find me in the morning, I'm asleep with some bananas, okay? And then in the morning, you find Shakespearean play. Oh Romeo, oh Romeo, wherefore art thou, oh Romeo? Deny thy father and deny thy name. Or if you want to make it more Islamic, oh Abdullah, oh Abdullah. deny thy mother, deny thy tribe. Yeah? So the point is, you would have expected small words like house, dog, tree. But since it conforms to the independent pattern of English grammar, and it conforms to the independent play of Shakespeare, you're going to be scratching your head. Especially if you hear the next statement I'm going to make. According to British mathematicians, a monkey to type to be or not to be from Hamlet's play in Shakespeare, do you know how long it would take? Someone give me some numbers, days, years, months. How many? 3 years. No. 10 years? No. Let me give you the answer. According to these mathematicians, it would take 28 billion years. The universe is only 1400 years old. So to accept the chance hypothesis is almost rejecting our very existence. So brothers and sisters, we have sufficient reasons to believe that the universe was designed. Let me summarize this argument for you. Number one. The fine-tuning of the universe is due to physical necessity, chance, or design. Number two, it is not due to physical necessity or chance. Three, therefore, it's due to design. And the Quran, the Book of the Muslims, eloquently summarizes the design argument. It says, in the creation of the universe, and the alternation of the night and day, and the ships which sail the seas to people's benefit, and the water which God sends down from the sky, by which he brings the earth to life when it was dead, and scatters about in it creatures of every kind, and the varying directions of the winds, and the clouds subservient between heaven and the earth, these are signs for people who use their intellect. The Quran is a book that engages with the human mind. Now, before I get to the miracle of the Quran, let me talk about one main contention, main argument against this argument. And you can find it in Richard Dawkins' book, The God Delusion, on page 157 to 158. And he says, it's very interesting, this design argument. I really like it. But there's a problem. And the problem is, who designed the designer? Well, this is highly problematic because in the philosophy of science, the best explanation doesn't require an explanation. Let me give you an example. Say we all went on the moon. Hada yalla, let's go. Yeah? We went to the moon and we were digging away. And you found some iPhone, some BlackBerry, some pottery, some arrowheads, some trainers, some sophisticated equipment, doctor's glasses, his watch, his beautiful t-shirt. Yeah? What would you conclude? That there must have been a civilization there. But wait 1 minute. Say Richard Dawkins comes along and he says, you can't claim such a thing. You don't know where they came from. You don't know their name. You don't know their color. You don't know anything about them. And then we would say, it doesn't mean our explanation is not the best explanation anymore. Because the best explanation doesn't require an explanation. Also, if you say the best explanation always requires an explanation, then we could say, well, what about the explanation for the explanation that explains the best explanation? But what about the explanation that explains the explanation that explains the explanation that explains the explanation for the best explanation? 1 minute. What about the explanation of the explanation that explains the explanation? Blah, 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 blah. If we do this forever, we will never have any explanations which undermine science itself. So this is not a very strong contention. Now let me go straight to the miracle of the Quran. Now first and foremost, a miracle is not defined as a violation of natural law. This is an old Western view, and it's an incorrect philosophical view on miracles. The Islamic philosophy or the Islamic thinking sees a miracle as an act of impossibility. which is more coherent. It makes more sense. Because if you exhaust all possible explanations in the natural world, then it means you have to start looking for supernatural explanations. And it makes sense of God's existence. Now, I'm going to discuss the Quran in two ways. Historical statements that make it a miracle and scientific statements that make it a miracle. Now let's go to the first one, the historical statements. Now the Quran mentions history and it does it in a way for us to reflect, to think, to ponder about our universe, about our own existence, about anthropology, about civilization, to really understand our reality. Civilizations have come and gone. Let's not have this civilization arrogance, this liberal hegemony, thinking that we have the best ideas and we want to spread them across the world. But the Quran says, be wary. Other civilizations have come and gone. Your time is coming and our time is coming. So think about our very existence. But also the Quran mentions history in a very specific way, in a way that I would argue defies nature. And let me tell you why. The Quran mentions a title for the leader of the Egyptians in two ways. In the story of Joseph, or Yusuf alayhi salam, the Quran mentions Malik, king, which means ruler, king, or sultan. But in the story of Moses, Musa alayhi salam, the Quran mentions the Pharaoh, or in Arabic, Fir'aun. And why does the Quran do this? Why does the Quran make this differentiation at two points in time? Because at the time of Yusuf, it was the old Middle Kingdom. At the time of Moses, it was the New Kingdom in the 14th century BC. And we know, according to the historians, if you could read the reference, the Encyclopedia Britannica. But why is this difference there? Especially since the Bible, which was existing at that time, never mentioned king, always mentioned Pharaoh. The Torah never mentioned king, always mentioned Pharaoh. The historians at the time never mentioned king, always mentioned Pharaoh. The historical knowledge at the time always mentioned king, always mentioned Pharaoh, never mentioned king. So think about this. At that time, they never mentioned king, only mentioned Pharaoh. Is the Quran wrong here? And just to make this a bit more elaborate, the Rosetta Stone, which was decoded in the 19th century, the Rosetta Stone that allowed us to read and understand the hieroglyphs, the Egyptian language, was only decoded many, many centuries after. So where did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam get this knowledge from? It didn't exist in the natural world at that time. And you can't claim it's a guess, because it's a very minute detail. It's irrelevant to the message of Islam. It's irrelevant to the existence of God. It's irrelevant to anything that the Quran talks about. But it makes this very specific, minute point. And it's accurate, because now we have the Rosetta Stone. We know at the old Middle Kingdom, they called the Pharaoh Malik, the leader of the Egyptians Malik. And at the New Kingdom, they called the leader of the Egyptians Pharaoh. How, why, and when did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam get such historical knowledge? If there's no naturalistic explanation, it shows that the supernatural is the best explanation. Now let me give you one of my favorite arguments now, something that the Islamic Education and Research Academy has studied for a while. And this is the embryology in the Quran. In Surah Al-Mu'minun, chapter 23, verses 12 to 14, there are approximately 8 beautiful points, eloquent points, describing the development of the human embryo in a very unique and eloquent way. I'm not going to go through all of them because it takes a lot of time, but we could discuss this in the Q&A. But let me give you some realities and examples of the lexical items, the words in the Quran, and relate them to modern science. First and foremost, the Quran mentions nutfa. Now, according to classical dictionaries like Lisan al-Arab and academic dictionaries like Lane's Lexicon, this word can mean a singular entity which is part of a bigger group of its kind, a single sperm from a collection of millions of sperms, and it can also refer to one female egg from a group of many other eggs in the ovaries. And according to the traditions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Musnad Ahmed, He explained the nutfa as a combination from the male and the female. And the Quran elsewhere in the previous chapter says the nutfa is a mingled substance. Now look at what the scientists have to say. Not Professor Keith Moore, which we've been using since the 80s. The scientists today, 2010. Embryologists, Beverly Kramer and John Allen, they say the human individual arises from the conjugation, the mixing, the mingling of two minute structures called cells, one from the mother and one from the father. These are called gametes. Together, these gametes form a single cell, the zygote, from which the entire embryo, including its surrounding membranes, grows. 100% in line with the Quranic narrative, from the male and from the female, and it's mingled, and it's a single substance that's mingled. Also, the Quran mentions qararin makin, which basically means in a safe place. So the nutfa has been put in a safe place. Again, the classical dictionaries and the academic dictionaries, they state that the word qarar means to make sedentary, to establish, to assign, to schedule, to determine, to stipulate, to regulate, to decide, and it carries the meaning to confirm and to affirm. The word makin has meanings that include to place, to put down, to set firmly, and to put in position. And relate this to the following modern science, 2010-2011. Embryologists John Allen and Beverly Kramer explain the process of implantation in a safe place. Listen to this. Implantation begins about the 6th to the 7th day after fertilization. The part of the blastocyst, and the blastocyst was formed from the zygote, the nutfa. Projecting into the uterine cavity remains relatively thin. The centrophoblast contains a proteolytic enzyme which causes the destruction of the endometrial cells so that the blastocyst sinks deeper and deeper into the uterine mucosa. The final deficiency in the endometrium is sealed off by a fibrin blood clot overlying the blastocyst. This cover is called the operculum. Now think about this. Implantation, it goes deeper and deeper and covered in a safe place, and gives the indication that it's in line with the Quranic narrative. Also, the Quran uses the word alaqa. Alaqa. This word, according to the classical dictionaries and the academic dictionaries, means to hang, to be suspended, to dangle, to stick, to clean, to cling, to cleave, and to adhere. It can also mean to catch, to get caught, affixed, and subjoined. And it can also mean a leech-like substance that takes its nutrients from blood. Now, the many meanings of this word, alaqa, correspond to modern embryology. This is particularly true for the various stages in the development of the human embryo. For instance, modern embryology clearly states that from day 15, the embryo is clinging or adhering to the connecting stalk, and it obtains its nutrients via contact with the maternal blood vessels. And listen to what embryologists Barry Mitchell and Ram Sharma have to say. They said, due to the rapid growth of the embryo, during the second week, there is a need for more efficient means of nutritional and gaseous exchange. This is achieved when the embryonic blood vessels of the chorion come into contact with the maternal blood vessels of the decidua. So this alaqa stage can refer to something that's clinging onto the connecting stalk, and you can see this, I have a book with you published in 2010 to indicate this, and also the blood vessels taking nutrients via the blood of the mother, just like a leech does. But also, it's even more profound. The leech-like substance actually could be seen not as just metaphorical, but actually as real. At day 21 to day 24, a very special thing happens to the embryo. It's called the folding of the embryo. And if you go to the academic medical pictures, which are online, type in day 21 or 24, you see the folding of the embryo, it looks just like a medicinal leech. To confirm this, embryologists Barry Mitchell and Ram Sharma, they say, longitudinal folding occurs between days 21 and 24. The endoderm forms like a tube-like structure which looks like a leech. Also, and let's mention one of the penultimate stages, the Quran mentions fakasona idham lahma. Fakasona idham lahma. Now, the word kasona means to clothe, dress, garb, and attire. This sentence means, and we clothed the bones with flesh, with muscle. So this word kasona means to clothe, dress, attire. It also carries a meaning to hang, to drape, to face, and to case. Also the word flesh is lahm, and it means flesh or a small piece of meat and a fleshy type of thing. Now John Allen and Beverly Kramer, the embryologists, they confirm how limb muscles are formed. And listen to this very carefully. Soon, after the cartilaginous models of the bones have been established, the myogenic cells, which have now become myoblasts, aggregate to form muscle masses on the ventral and dorsal aspects of the limbs. Think about this. They aggregate for kasona, to encase, to cover, to wrap, to veil. A process that cannot be seen with the naked eye. And to reconfirm this, Barry Mitchell and Ram Sharma, they explain what happens. They say the myoblasts then migrate distally. They move and migrate distally, fakasona, to hang, to veil, to clothe, to encase, over the muscle, over the bones, to create muscle masses surrounding the developing skeleton. This is 100% in line with modern embryology. So, let's put this in context. There's a lot of science, but let's put this in context. How can we explain this in light of the fact that this is relatively new science? How can we explain when the possible technology didn't exist at the time? What does it tell you about the author? Especially since the only embryology they knew was Aristotelian and accounts from Galen, the two physicians and philosophers at the time. And their descriptions of the developing embryo was based on the naked eye, on dissections, and they were inaccurate. Listen to this, for example. Galen attributed to the semen, which what we now attribute to the fertilized ovum. The Quran doesn't mention this. Aristotle said that only the semen has the power of the faculties, and it mixes with menstrual blood. The Quran doesn't mention this, it mentions nutfa. Also, Aristotle indicated that you could have a male and a female depending where the embryo is in the womb. Something totally inaccurate. And there are so many things that are inaccurate with the embryology of Aristotle and Galen, which was predominant at that time. So to claim the Prophet copied this would be to claim a mass conspiracy. Because say he did copy it, what did he do? He knew what was bad and he left it. He took what was similar, made it better, and actually mentioned stages that are in line with modern embryology but wasn't mentioned at that time. To claim such a thing would be equivalent of saying that your mom's not your mom. Because you have to answer so many questions. How did he know what was correct? How did he add all the other new stages? It's a conspiracy. And this is why many atheists on the web and so-called academics are trying to refute these claims. Upon our studies, we've seen that they're very shallow claims. So in absence of knowledge at the time, we can't find natural reasons why the Quran would have brought about statements that are totally in line with modern embryology. What does it say about the author? It says it's not from nature, it's from the supernatural, meaning from the design. So brothers, sisters, and friends, let me summarize today's debate. We have good reasons to believe that God exists based on the creation of the universe. We have good reasons to believe that God exists based on the fine-tuning of the universe to permit our existence, and the best explanation is design. And we've got good reasons that God is a truth and not a fairy tale, because the Quran can only be best explained by God, because the statements it makes with regards to history and the statements it makes with regards to embryology cannot be explained naturalistically, so they're an indication to the divine, the supernatural. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta wa astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
JazakAllah khair, Brother Hamza and Lars Gule. Now we will have Dr. Lars Gule to present his view.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. I will try to say something about God from a humanist perspective. And the first question to ask then is, what is God? God is a human creation. And it's a special kind of human creation. Philosophically, we call this a hypostasization, which means that we have something created, and in this case, an abstraction, a concept, an idea, that returns and appears as the creator of the one who created the concept. So, this is why God is a projection with human traits and feelings. And this is what we have seen throughout history, that God has been presented as a variety of man, as male, female, strong, small, good-looking, bad-looking, ugly, evil, benign. All of these characteristics we have seen in the various gods that man has created throughout history. The more sophisticated forms of God, the monotheistic God, or gods, perhaps we should say, because one could always argue that the Jewish, Christian, and Muslim God is not really the same God. And there are good arguments to say that we are talking about different, at least different concepts of God. And at the same time, we have a history of saying it's the same God. It's the Abrahamic God that all these three religions share. Still, if you look at the history of this concept of God, it is a very human image. It's a human image of God in Jewish scriptures, it's a human image in Christian scriptures, and it's a very human image in the Quran and other Muslim, Islamic scriptures. Why have we created God? The creation of God is a result of our need to understand and find meaning in the world. As human beings, we are looking for purpose, we are looking for meaning, we are trying to see patterns, because this is part of our biological, psychological makeup. And this has survival value. Our ability to reason, to recognize, and to search for meaning behind action, and particularly behind the actions of other human beings, gives us survival value. Because if you don't understand that a smile is a sign of friendship and peace, but maybe it's a false smile. Maybe this is something that we have to look out for. Can I really trust this person? For that reason, we are looking at what is happening around us, and we are trying to understand what is going on around us. And experience learns, teaches us very quickly that there are something behind appearances. Oh yes, I heard yesterday, they talked about me. They said something about me. Could it be that that smile is an ironic smile? That it's a smirk because he heard something about me yesterday? This way of attempting to find meaning in the world is an obvious psychological mechanism in the creation of gods, spirits, angels. Isn't there something particular? Isn't there a personality to that tree? Why did that rock suddenly appear in the road? That rock must have had an evil intention since I hurt my foot on it. But that's a naive idea. The belief in God is no more sophisticated than the belief in spirits in rocks and trees. It is exactly the same type of search for meaning. Well, as our knowledge expands, we have to make the idea of God more abstract, because the God as the ruler of thunder, Zeus, are the Nordic gods, Odin, Thor. Thor driving his chariot drawn by goats across the skies and creating thunder with his hammer. It's a bit outdated today. So if you are going to maintain an idea of a purpose behind everything, well, then you need a more abstract god. So you can also look at the evolution or development of the concept of God throughout history. And the Muslim concept of God has developed. The idea of Hamza, the idea that he thinks he's taken straight out of the Quran, is a result of many hundreds of years of Islamic philosophy, theology, kalam, thinking about God. You cannot find that image in the Quran. It needs to be interpreted out of the Quran. Perhaps is this also our belief in gods, perhaps it is also a result of what we could call hyper-rationality. We have the ability to reason, that has survival value, that is useful for us as human beings, but it could have the side effect that we become too rational, that we are looking for too much meaning and purpose in the world. Conspiracy theories are one example of how we see more meaning than there actually is in the world. And the search for God could be, I'm not saying it is, but could be, it's a hypothesis worth investigating, could be another effect of our ability to reason, but an ability that runs amok, so to speak. But the ideas of God, the religious ideas of God with the characteristics imputed into God or gods are also reproduced as a result of alienation, social frustration, oppression, and injustice. In short, it's reproduced based on our need for comfort. Our need to see that, well, there will be some justice at the end of it all. Unfortunately, the world isn't like that. The world is full of injustice, and we do not have any guarantee for any rectification of the injustices in this life, nor in the hereafter, simply because there is no hereafter. So, why is there no God, in my opinion? First of all, simply, there are no proofs for the existence of God. We do not have any scientifically interesting or valid evidence for the existence of a God. Hamza has presented two classical arguments, and I will rebut them more thoroughly later, and that's the argument from creation and the argument from design, cosmogony and cosmology. But there is no need for a God in order to explain the world. Science can explain the world without God, and it explains the world better without the hypothesis or theory of a God as the cause of everything. Furthermore, the concept of God as we find it in the monotheistic religions is contradictory. It is inconsistent. And if you have a concept that is inconsistent, it means that attaching any value to it or believing it as something that could exist is senseless. If you can show that something is meaningless, absurd, contradictory, then you have used what philosophers called a reductio ad absurdum. You have shown that something is absurd. And for that reason, you have also disproved the relevance and existence of what the concept tries to give you a grasp of. Now, why is the concept of God contradictory? Because the claim is, and the claim goes much further than we have heard so far, the claim is that God is all love, omnipotent, and all-knowing. Still, there is evil in the world. This is a logical contradiction. And this contradiction is amplified within Islam because the insistence of God as the creator of everything and the immediate creator of everything. And this is a very important consequence of Islamic philosophical theology, because there are various ways of interpreting the God of the Quran. There is an opening for a God that accepts free will. There is an opening for a God that determines everything in detail. And the philosophical discussion came out in favor of those who says there is no free will and God is the cause of everything, immediately. Now, if you can lend me the pen. And this is an example from Al-Ghazali, the great Imam himself. He says, I did not choose to pick up the pen voluntarily, and I am not the one who is causing the pen to write my name on the paper now. No, that act is created by God as I write. And at the same time, God has created the idea in my head that I chose to pick up the pen and write my name. In such a world, God is responsible for everything. Necessarily also everything that is evil in the world. And then to say that God is merciful and compassionate, that he wants the best for man and mankind, becomes ridiculous. It becomes meaningless. It becomes, in short, absurd. If God is the cause of everything, we have a meaningless situation. We have an immoral, actually, we have an evil God. A God that would say, those go to hell, I don't care. Those go to heaven, I don't care. Hadith. That's a cynical and, in my view, evil God. I don't want to believe in an evil God. So even if there was any reasons, like creation, like design, for the existence of God, I wouldn't want to believe in an evil God. Furthermore, we have strange, if not absurd, anthropomorphisms in the Quran. The Islamic God can see, he can hear, and he sits on his thrones, and he has hands to grasp with. Read the Quran. But at the same time, he cannot have hands, he cannot have eyes, he cannot have ears, and he definitely cannot have a backside, because then he would look like a human. And if there is something that is wrong in Islam, it is to say that God looks like a human being. Still, it's there. The image of man is projected into God. How to solve this? You can't solve it. Well, they tried anyway. So what did they say? Bila kaifa. We don't know how. God hears, but we don't know how he hears. We don't know what he hears with. He is seeing, but we don't know what he is seeing with. And we should not ask. We should not ask. You should not inquire into these things. Why not? Why not? Oh, could confuse your mind. You could start to doubt the existence of God. Ah, dangerous thing. Even though the same Quran says, seek knowledge even until China. So, the Quran contradicts itself. Now, if God is unknowable, why should we believe? Then you have to rely on authority. You should not inquire. You should accept the words of those who know. Who knows? The scholars, the learned? Well, then you have to submit to their very human authority. Not the authority of God, but human authority. Because there is always humans who are interpreting the Quran and telling you that you should not inquire further. Besides, the Jewish, but not to the same extent as the Christian, but to the largest extent, the Muslim God, is also evil because he wants to torture men and women for all eternity. Muhammad's first message was, repent, recognize God, or you will go to the fire. Yawm ad-Din had two gates. One was hellfire, the other was paradise, and I believe Hamza told you about paradise yesterday. So those of you who would like to go there, have a nice image. My point is that the other outcome of life is eternal damnation, which is cruel and inhuman. Even to say that Anders Behring Breivik should burn in hell for eternity is such because eternity. What is eternity? Do you know what eternity is? It's in itself a dangerous and difficult concept. But if it should have any meaning at all, it means a torture that we cannot imagine. And a God who says that someone, for some reason, should be tortured forever is an evil God. We also know that God is a terrorist because he holds the whole of humanity as a hostage for the evil doings of some people. Muslims accept the flood, which meant that God destroyed all of mankind because of the wickedness of some men. And if you say, no, it was all mankind who had become corrupt, it is not true, because God, with the flood, killed the unborn babies in mother's womb. They were innocent, and they were destroyed by this tyrant. Another reason why you should not believe in this idea of God. Finally, one should not believe in God. And this is also a reason why we can assume, have good reasons to assume that there is no God, is the evil that is caused by the belief in God. Not what God is alleged to have said and done and required. But we have seen torture, we have seen war, we have seen oppression, we have seen extermination, all committed in the name of God. And if you now say, well, that's the abuse of the word of God. That's the abuse. This is not how it was meant. Well, then it means that you sit there with knowledge of the will of God that the prophet did not have because he went to war, that the caliphs did not have because they went to war, that the sultans did not have because they went to war. If you are said that these are the false words, the false representation of the will of God, you are saying that we know better. And of course, you are not oppressing your wives, sisters, and other women. Why are they sitting there? And the men here? A clear example of the differentiation that ends in discrimination between men and women. And that has been seen throughout the history of Islam, as well as in all other religions. You have this subjugation and discrimination of women. You have the subjugation and oppression of non-believers. And we have seen it in all religions, and we have seen it in Islam. No difference. Now, nice people from Islamnet have been standing outside the World Humanist Congress in Oslo, and we have had peaceful arguments. And I'm here invited by you for a peaceful argument, or perhaps a heated argument, but nevertheless, non-violent argument. We have humanist colleagues from Muslim countries that live in fear of their lives because they do not follow the beliefs of the Quran. Why should they? Why should humanists live in fear of their lives? Why should Ahmadiyya Muslims in Pakistan live in fear of their lives? Because they disagree with the majority. And if you say, yeah, well, sorry, we are very sorry. The majority of the Muslims in Pakistan have misunderstood. Yes, if they have misunderstood, where is your protest? Where are your protests against the oppression of those who believe otherwise, being oppressed in the name of Islam? Do you want to build mosques in Oslo? And I support your right to do so. Where is your argument for the right to build a church in Mecca? There has been acceptance of slavery in Islam. The Quran accepts slavery. Is it wrong? Why has it been abolished? Is it abolished? Why do we actually see slavery still existing in some Muslim countries? Again, misrepresentation of Islam? Perhaps. But where is the Muslim protest? Where do I hear your protest? The belief in God has resulted in the rejection of human rights consistently in practically all religions. The Norwegian state church accepted human rights roughly after the Second World War. Before that, they were not that important. Many Muslims say, human rights? No way. All the human rights that God has given to humans, we find in Islam and Sharia. So therefore, we don't need to concern ourselves with it. And that's why you are quiet when people are oppressed, when their freedom of religion is oppressed. The belief in God, the supreme authority, has led to the rejection of democracy. And a standard attitude amongst theologians, the learned ones in Islam, is it's better with 40 years of tyranny than one day of anarchy. In that way, Islam has consistently been used to defend every dictatorial regime since the caliphs that were suspect in the Umayyad dynasty in the 7th century. This is perhaps the most serious reason why the belief in God is a dangerous belief and why it should be rejected. It leads to, in most cases, consequences that are worse than non-belief. To try to sum up, science can explain the world better without God than with God. The belief in God is the belief in a concept that doesn't hold water. It is inconsistent. Furthermore, the belief in such an inconsistent concept leads to evil things and should be avoided. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lars Gule, for your presentation. Now we will have Hamza giving his rebuttal to Dr. Lars Gule's arguments for God's non-existence. Thank you.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Okay, first and foremost, I think I mentioned the universe was 1400 years old. I meant to say 14 billion years old, okay? We're not like the young earth creationists like the Christians, so apologies for that. Okay, first and foremost, as a quick statement, I think most of what Doctor has said has been emotional, political arguments that do not negate the God's existence. Talking about politics, Pakistan, Afghanistan, oppression, violence, tyranny, I don't want... This doesn't negate God's existence, and plus the huge opinions. There's nothing that we heard today that is an undercutting defeater to any of the arguments we constructed. And he hasn't constructed an argument for humanism. Rather, he's just thrown small stones at a big wall. Also, I'd like to say that he's saying that the concept of a God is actually a human concept. Well, does this sound very human to you? Eternal and immaterial? Is that human? Can that be a product of an evolved mind, thinking of something that's eternal and immaterial? Polytheism is maybe in line with evolution, because all you see is the material world, so there's many gods. But a transcendent, immaterial God that's eternal, that can never be the product of an evolved mind. Secondly, the doctor mentioned about it's a psychological mechanism. This is a strategy used by the atheists and humanists, because we have a problem, the Muslims and the religious people, because we're so sad, we need a big father figure up there to make us feel happy. That's the reality, people. And I think it's unacademic, it's non-philosophical, it's absurd, because I converted to Islam, I came from a secular humanist background, my dad was like a philosopher. And I came to the religion based on rational arguments, based on the Qur'an. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Have you not seen the camel and how we created it? أَوَلَمْ يَتَفَكَّرُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. Do they not reflect within themselves? وَكَذَلِكَ نُفَصُّلُ الْآيَاتِ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. And thus to explain our signs and evidences in detail for those يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, who reflect. Not those who ponder amongst the psychological weakness, but those who reflect. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Do you not use your mind? All in the Qur'an. All in the Qur'an. So this is an outdated atheist humanist cliche. Also, the doctor was talking about the concept of one God has evolved. This is not true. If you go to the historical works, we see that monotheism was at least mentioned 4000 BC. At least. It's not an evolving concept. Monotheism was mentioned at least 4000 BC. At least just before the Bronze Age or the beginning of the Bronze Age. Also, the doctor said that the concept of God is incoherent or does not relate to reality because there's too much evil in the world. This is another outdated humanist cliche. Now I want to ask everybody a question. When we say evil, do we mean evil is real and objective? Because surely to make value judgments, I mean doctor has made a lot of value judgments, oppression, tyranny, subjugation, evil, nasty, all these words. Now these words carry weight. They must be objective. Now, if there are objective, God must exist. Why am I saying this? Because moral, objective values can only exist if God exists. Because God is the only foundation for objective morality. Because the concept of God transcends, goes above and beyond human difference. And I spoke about this with Dr. yesterday, and he agreed. I don't believe morals are objective. He believes in relativism or social relativism, that people come together to make the ideas amongst themselves. Hence, Nazi Germany killing 6 million Jews is not objectively morally wrong according to his philosophy, but according to ours it is, because we have a conceptual grounding for our morality, which is God's existence. Now you may think, 1 minute, bas chup kar, ekmit. Now you may think, okay, well evolution is a grounding for our morality. Social pressure is a grounding for our morality, but it's not. Evolution, what's evolution? Evolution says that we're an accidental byproduct of a lengthy evolutionary process. Our morals have evolved like our ears or our teeth or your unwanted nose hair. That's the reality, they have no greater meaning. And evolutionary biological changes are ever changing. And if they're ever changing, moral norms will change. Okay, let's give up on that one. Social pressure, well if human beings come together and decide something, how does that make it objective? There's an organization called the North American Men and Young Boys Lover Association, NAMBLA. And they are trying to use human rights legislation to allow old men to sleep with small little boys. God knows in 50 years' time, if the social consensus is there, it will be a morally good thing to do. So the point I'm trying to say is the problem of evil is a problem for the atheist. Because if they're saying evil is real and objective, it necessitates God's existence in the first place. Also, I'd like to add that God is not just good. There's a straw man argument. You've built a straw man of God, a fake argument of God. Because God is not just good, he's also the wise. And we believe behind everything is the wisdom of God. Now you may argue, I can't see the wisdom. Well, you can argue from ignorance, which is a logical fallacy called argumentum ad ignoratiam, but it doesn't mean that God is not wise. So that defeats the problem of evil. Also, the doctor said about that there's a lot of anthropomorphisms in the Quran. This is a very shallow reading of the Quran. The Quran is full of Tawheed, the oneness of God. When we look at God's attributes and his names, we know that we relate it to the statement, Laysa kamithlihi shay, there is nothing like God. So we affirm what God has said, but we don't know the modality. We don't understand the modality. And this is not incoherent because we know the universe expands, but do we know how? Just because we don't know how, doesn't mean the universe doesn't expand anymore? Do you see my point? Also, the philosophy of language that the Arabs adopt is a different philosophy from maybe the German school of philosophy of language. For existence, think of the word wing. What does a wing mean? You may think bird, but we also have a wing of a hospital, a wing of a plane. So there's an innate concept that doesn't have a translation into the physical world. And this is what we say with regards to the attributes of God. They're unique and one, and we reject anthropomorphisms. Also, he was saying God's a terrorist, that's an emotional argument. We believe God is the most loving. Al-Hudud. Al-Hudud means excessively loving. There's a prophetic teaching that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, God is more loving than a mother to her child, and there's no greater mercy than the mother to her child. So imagine the transcendent love that God has given to the human beings. And God wants to send you to hell. That's not the reality. A good reading of the Quran tells us that we made ourselves go there. God says, don't blame me, blame your own hands. The spiritual cause and effect of reality. And I think these are some of the counter arguments to some of the things that he said. But the rest of the stuff like gender issues, etc., we could address in the Q&A because they don't really negate God's existence. But just on a final note, the creation of the universe, no counter-argument. The design of the universe, no counter-argument. The miracle of the Quran, no counter-argument. I want a counter-argument now. Because we can't just be rhetorical and airy-fairy and just have a nice time and have a pint of milk, or beer in your case. The point is, we need to be just. We have an epistemic duty, we have a duty to knowledge to argue these claims. So I'm looking forward to your rebuttals, and I'm looking forward to rebutting your rebuttals. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you very much, Hamza. Now we will have Dr. Lars Gule for his rebuttal.
Now, I did, of course, not rebut Hamza's argument in my introduction because I was invited here to answer this question. And that's what I tried to do. I tried to answer why I see the idea of God as a fairy tale, not truth, and I also pointed out some of the bad consequences of belief in this fairy tale. Now, I will try to point out some of the problems in Hamza's presentation, but I do object to his presentation of our discussion the other day, which was video filmed, and you can look at it. There is a difference between objective values and absolute values. I do believe in objective values. Objective values springs from human existence, from human emotions, from human experience. Pain is a real experience. And on that basis, we know that we should avoid to inflict pain. And that's fairly objective for me. It's not absolute. In certain circumstances, it is right to give a small child an experience of pain, not because you want to harm it, on the contrary, because you want to give it an inoculation and save it from disease in the future. The point here is that it is absolutely possible to talk about objective values without making these values absolute in the religious sense. We'll come back to that. It is true, for humanists, there is no ultimate meaning in the sense that there is an absolute meaning. Life is here and now. Does it matter that we exist? Well, if you require an ultimate meaning and you say there is no such ultimate meaning, then our existence is meaningless in that perspective. But each and every one of you, for most of the time, feel that, yes, life is worth living. It has value. And that's the point of life from a humanist perspective. We give it value. We give it meaning. We give meaning to our lives. We do not rely on some imaginary divine being to give purpose and meaning to our lives. We have the responsibility to create that for ourselves. Now, science can be difficult. Nothing came out of nothing. The answer to that is simply that we do not know. It is a philosophical or theological proposition that nothing comes out of nothing. But how do we know? It is an allegedly logical argument. But a lot of so-called logical arguments have been corrected by science. Some things that we thought was impossible turn out to be quite possible anyway. The universe could very well have created itself. There is no bigger mystery in the universe creating itself than that God was uncreated or created him herself. What's the difference? It's only a difference if you want to make it a big difference. The biggest difference is that if you say God was there from eternity till eternity, there is nothing more to ask about. There is nothing more to inquire into. If you say the universe could have created itself, or it could have recreated itself from previous universes, oh, then you have an amazing amount of questions to ask and to inquire into. And this is what science is doing. Did the universe create itself? Did it spring from former universes? And material, immaterial? Don't make my position out to be a simple materialist position, because then you are really revealing that you don't know anything about modern science. How many dimensions do a modern cosmologist need to explain the universe? Quiet? 9, 12, 19, 21. Take your pick. Of course, these dimensions are not material. But they are not divine. They are not inscrutable. They can be researched. They can be calculated. They can be made theories about. And then they can be tested. This is modern science. Much more amazing than any belief in religion. If you have God, then you have all the answers, period. If you believe, in inverted commas, in science, then you have really a lot of work ahead of you. Fascinating work. Now, the discussion about causes relates to this. Science is concerned with causes, natural causes. If you have the ultimate cause as God, you could say, yes, well, we are not opposed to science. Our Islamic beliefs are not opposed to science. We accept science. But before the Big Bang, there is God. And then he set the whole thing in motion as the first mover. Fine. Then we will agree about a lot and disagree about certain cosmological and cosmogonical positions. If you are saying, no, God is the actual creator of everything every second, then you have ruined science, and then we go to another Muslim. And I leave the floor to him. Al-Ghazali wrote about the incoherence of the philosophers, and Ibn Rushd, 100 years later, rebutted Al-Ghazali and wrote about the incoherence of the incoherence of Al-Ghazali. Because Ibn Rushd was a defender of reason. He was a Muslim defender of reason. So there is a limit to how much abstraction you can put into the God. Final point in this round, the fine-tuning. This is not only a Muslim argument. This is a religious argument that we hear from many. It's the so-called anthropocentric argument. Since we are here, there must have been some fine-tuning there at the beginning so that we would appear. The whole point of modern evolutionary understanding of cosmology is that, no, if there had been a different variable present at the beginning, we wouldn't have been here. But the fact is that we are here. And that's the outcome of 13, 14 billion years of physical, chemical, biological evolution. If you take time into consideration, then you will see this. Hamza makes a big deal out of what the Quran says about conception, the fetus, as if common people didn't know a lot more than Aristotle and Galen about what went on in the womb of a mammal. Arabs bred horses. They knew a lot about what male and female meant. They knew a lot about what would come out if there was a miscarriage. And if you look at the fetus of an animal and a human being, in the first 21 days, they are almost indistinguishable. Almost indistinguishable. So Muhammad could very well have picked up a lot of information from his surroundings and put it into the Quran. And what does the Quran say about astronomy? Now, if this book is supposed to be divinely inspired or actually the word of God, everything has to be correct. Check what it says about astronomy. There are people, thorough, well-versed in the Quran, says that the earth is flat, that the earth moves around, that the sun moves around the earth. If you don't believe me, this is on the curriculum, still in madrasas in Saudi Arabia. Today, where do they get it from? Unreasonable reading? Oh no, no, that's a metaphor. Of course, that's a metaphor. But biology is not a metaphor. You can't pick and choose. So, there is no miracle in the Quran at all. Science is about causes. It's also about probabilities. It's also fascinating how you can try to calculate probabilities. And of course, you can calculate the probability of almost everything. If you take time into consideration, yes, 28 billion years, and a monkey would have written Shakespeare. We haven't experienced that yet. And why should we try to test it? The fact is, and that's an actual scientific fact, that after 13 billion years of a Big Bang, we appeared.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lars Gule. Now we have the question and answer session. This is your session, and this is your opportunity to challenge our speakers on what they have said today on the topic God, fairy tale, or truth. We would like you to make two cues, one over here for the gents, and one on the balcony for ladies. And if you have questions, we will ask our speakers to answer those questions. One question for Dr. Lars Gule and one question for Hamza Andreas Tzortzis. So if you have any questions, please come to the microphones on the right side. And for the sisters, please come to the microphone on the balcony up there. We have some basic rules we would like you all to follow during the Q&A session. The question, number one, must be related to the topic. Number two, this is question and answer session, not lecturing time. So please put forward your question within 40 seconds only. We would request every questionnaire to kindly state his name, profession, and belief before he puts forward his question. Do we have any brothers or any sisters who would like to ask any questions? Then they could come forward to the mics right now. The first question will be to Hamza. Do we have any questions for Hamza?
Up there.
Okay. Okay, wait. We have one sister up there first, so we're going to give her preference, and after that we will give you preference. Question for Hamza. You have 5 minutes to answer that, and he will give you the time, okay? Fantastic. One second, you got to put the microphone on. Do we have sound? Continue, please.
Yes. I have some questions about the objectivity of morality, as you talked about. And I have some questions, I have one question for that, and one question about the objectivity of the Quran. Because you said that the Quran, that you can find all these knowledge, scientific knowledge in the Quran. And then I wonder, why doesn't the Quran specify how you do Ramadan in Norway? Why is it so hard in summer and so easy in winter? And why is it not possible in Tromsø? So that's one question about the objectivity. And then, okay. Just one question at a time?
One question at a time. Thank you very
much. Okay.
Hamza, then I would request you to come up to the stage. And I will start your time when you start talking.
Okay, thank you very much for your question. It's a very valid question. Thank you for that. First and foremost, with regards to the Quran and why hasn't it mentioned about Ramadan and why is it so hard in the summer and so easy in the winter? Well, the Quran has mentioned values and principles to do with many affairs across time. For instance, the Quran mentions that Ramadan is not supposed to be very hard for you. It's supposed to be easy for you. It's an act of worship to come closer to God. لَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ in order for you to gain God consciousness. So the Quran says if you are unable to fast because of extreme time, for instance, and it's unbearable physically, then you just pay charity every day. So the Quran mentions a solution. So there's no problem. The Quran does do that. I think what I would advise to you is that we should read the Quran with an open mind, with an open heart, and with critical reading. If you don't understand anything, ask the brothers and the sisters, and I'm sure they'll be able to elaborate carefully and nicely, with compassion, on our thoughts, processes, and the jurisprudence as a result from the Quran, the prophetic teachings. And also you mentioned about the scientific statements in the Quran. Well, see, the Quran does make the scientific statements, and what you hear from Dr. Lars Gule, he said basically, people at the time could have had that information, but I think he wasn't attentive when I mentioned Aristotle and Galen, how they did mistakes because of dissections. Dissections doesn't tell you everything about the human embryo because you only have the naked eye, and we did not have technology to understand how the myoblast cells migrate distally and form muscle masses over the bones. What Dr. Lars has done is cleverly just ignored that. He's ignored that aspect of the Quran and said, well, you know, they had information at the time. They could go to a horse, and find how a horse's embryo in the early stages is the same as human. They could do dissections, so it's fine. But this is an inaccurate perspective of what happened. The Quran mentions things that you can't see with the naked eye. The nutfah, from the male and the female, coming together, mingle to form the zygote. Aristotle got it wrong. He said it's the semen with the menstrual blood. Galen got it wrong. He said all the faculties belong to the semen. So if the Prophet did copy the knowledge of that time, how did he fix it? How did he make it more accurate? How did he make it more in line with scientific knowledge? This is why Dr. Lars has to be more attentive to the argument with the Quran, because the argument of the Quran mentions stages of embryology that can't be seen with the naked eye. And I give you another example again. The cells that cannot be seen with the naked eye, they migrate distally over the bones. Unheard of in Aristotle, unheard of in Galen, unheard of at the time, and impossible to see with the physical eye in dissections. This is where we have to be attentive to the argument and be honest with what we're saying, rather than just quickly putting things to the side, assuming, oh, he copied it from somewhere. If he did, you have to explain how he fixed it, he knew what was wrong, and ignored it. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Now the next question will be from the gents' side, and the question would be to Dr. Lars Gule.
Bismillah. Thank you. My name is Adnan Rashid. I'm from IRA. Dr. Gule, thank you so much for your fascinating case, although it didn't convince me. My question is with regards to your emotional arguments, although they're not directly related to the topic, but you did raise them. And again, they relate to the miracle of the Quran, as Hamza mentioned. Miracle of the Quran as one of his evidences for the existence of God. Quran asserts in chapter 21, verse number 107, that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent as a mercy for the worlds. And then we see this mercy manifested historically in Islam, contrary to what you said. For example, Professor Thomas Arnold from the School of Oriental and African Studies, the University of London, he wrote a book on Islam, the preaching of Islam, and he argued that Islam was the best thing which ever happened to mankind. That's what he said. I'm not saying this. That's what he said. Also, we have Jewish scholars who argue that the best time in the history of Judaism was when they were living under Islamic government. For example, Zion Zohar, he wrote in his book that when the Muslims landed in Spain, the Jews opened the doors for them as liberators. Then we have another scholar, an Israeli historian. His name is Amnon Cohen. I'm going to finish my question very soon. Amnon Cohen, he wrote that during the Ottoman era, 1,000 Jews from the year 1530 to 1600, within these 70 years, 1,000 Jews came to the Islamic court for justice rather than going to the rabbi. So I can give you many more examples. An example on top of an example. And it's very, very clear historically that Western academics have argued that Islam was very merciful to the other, to the Jews and the Christians. And the reason some of the minor Christian sects and the Jewish religion survived was due to the protection of Islam. Do you concede to this point? And do you accept the conclusions of those historians? And if you do, then do you take back your assertions against Islam? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your question. Just for next time, everyone please try to state your question within 40 seconds. And I've realized that if we're going to do switch from the women's side and the gents' side, only women would be asking questions to Hamza and only brothers would be asking to Dr. Lars. So we're going to take two questions from the brother's side and two questions from the sister's side and switch like this, okay?
There is a great difference between saying that the Quran, by extension, Islam, is the best that has happened to mankind, and to say that Islamic rule or the rule of Muslims has benefited Jews and Christians in many instances. The last is what scholars are saying. If someone says that it's the best that ever happened to mankind, that is definitely an unscientific statement. It might be the statement of a Muslim or a sympathizer with Islam, but it is definitely not a historical correct statement. Because I have no problems, and I have actually on very, very many occasions explained to those critical of Islam, those fearful of Islam, and Islamophobes that Islam, in many instances, has represented an improvement and a better situation for non-believers, for Jews and Christians, than, for example, Christian rule represented for Jews in Europe. But that this was the situation. In some countries, under some Muslim rulers, some of the time, does not mean that other rulers did not oppress Christians and Jews and others with a different faith. That happened also. So if you are going to have a correct picture of the consequences of a certain religion, you have to look at the whole picture. You cannot pick and choose. Because then you are saying that, well, I picked those things, and those rulers, that part of history represents the Islam I want to defend. But then you are saying that all other Muslims are wrong, and you might say so, but then say it out loud. Say then that, well, they are simply wrong, and they were wrong in the past. I know better. Say it out loud. This is the only decent position. If you try to pretend that, well, they were Muslims, so I don't want to criticize them, and there must have been something better, at least better than the Jews and the Christians, then you are a hypocrite. Then you're a munafiq. And you shouldn't be. You should actually face up to historical reality and look at the whole picture, not pick and choose. So my answer to the question is, yes, in certain circumstances, Islam represented an improvement for those who came under Muslim rules. In other instances, it meant that life became worse. Often it also became worse for Muslims themselves.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lars Gule. Now we will have two questions from the sister side. The first question to Hamza. Please come forward to the microphone.
I have a question about the objectivity of morality. You said that if you don't believe in Allah, you don't have the objectivity. I say if the objectivity is more happiness for more and less suffering for most people. And then you can argue what does make that happiness, but it is this is the goal, and you negotiate. Then I have been in a discussion on Facebook today, and we discussed about, I don't know, mutter, that's the word, is it? The one-hour marriage, which some scholars, some Muslim scholars, said was legal. For me, this is something that makes suffering. And the same, in the same area where they practice this, which makes suffering, they also stone women for adultery, which I regard as not objective and inconsistent, but from the Quran. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your question. Hamza, would you like to address that?
That was a very good question. The lady raised some very important points. First and foremost, she said about objective morality, and she said, can you have objective morality if you don't believe in Allah? See, that's not the argument. If we're attentive to what I'm saying is, if objective morals exist, it necessitates the existence of God. Believing in God or not makes no difference. You can't be good and yet not believe in the divine. You can't display good behavior not believing in the divine. What I'm saying is, if you take the position that morals are objective, it necessitates God's existence, because God is the only foundation for objective morality. If you could find another one for me,
then let's talk about it. But evolution is makes it subjective and relative. Social pressure makes it subjective and relative. This is why Dr. Lars Gule, he said, well, the difference between absolute and objective, again, we're playing linguistic games. He said, it's objective for me. The statement for me has made it subjective. So it's objective, subjective. Because it's objective for me. It's objective for you, which means it's objective for your personal space, which makes it subjective anyway. Now, with regards to the 1 hour marriage, the majority of the Muslims reject this and it's not in line with the Islamic tradition. That's all I have to say about that. It comes from the Shia tradition, and the majority of the scholars and even the non-Muslim scholars have argued that the Shia methodology, the Shia theology is not in line with the base text of the Quran because of aspects of polytheism as attributed to personalities like Ali and the 12 Imams. But that's a different discussion, it's a theological discussion, but it's outside of the theological framework of Sunni Islam. The other aspect you talked about, the severe punishments, the suitably harsh punishments. Now, I'm not here to justify them to you because I don't think Islam requires any justification. Just like many of the liberals don't think that liberal interventionism when you go into Iraq and Afghanistan requires any justification. However, I want to be very clear. And in Islam, the suitably harsh punishments are there as a deterrent effect. Muslims don't want everyone's hand to be cut off. Muslims don't want everyone to be stoned. That's not the reality of the Muslim. The Muslim's here to show mercy and compassion. What happens is the suitably harsh punishments, they are there to act as a deterrent. And the conditions for those punishments are so hard, are so difficult, that it's almost impossible for any of these punishments to come into practice. For example, for someone to get stoned to death, you need 4 pious witnesses that saw the act. As the scholars say, the pen goes in the ink. Okay? And you had to see it done in public. You don't even see that in Oslo. You don't even see that in the worst place in Soho in London. You don't even see that in the red light district. And even you say, oh, but I saw them in the house. You're not a pious witness anymore. Because for you to spy on someone means you're not pious. So the point is, in the Islamic tradition, it's not everyone to go crazy. Because look, let's be very frank here. The Islamic tradition is very powerful because we need these things. In the Western world, there's 167 rapes every day in London, in England. 90,000 rapes a year, according to Amnesty International. In every 4 women, 1 woman is battered and beaten in England. In America, every 13 seconds, a woman is beaten. Every 6 seconds, she's raped. This is the reality of Western liberal countries because they don't have an advocation of morality. They have to have a principal distance to morality, as in the words of Professor Will Klimlicher, who's a liberal philosopher. And this is why we have these moral problems. But if you have the Islamic solution, it prevents these things from happening. Just on a final note, we have to go away from this, from the BBC, the media, CNN, and Fox News narrative on punishments. It's a very cartoon of the Sharia, a very detailed law. Just imagine, outside a shop, you have a guy with a huge beard. Then you have a woman covering her hands and face with a sword by her side. And there's a small Norwegian guy who's hungry. He goes to the shop and steals a cookie. The guy trips him up with his beard. He falls on the floor. The niqab, he takes the niqab off, gets the sword, cuts his hand. Allahu Akbar. This is the cartoon. This is the cartoon of Sharia law. And I think that Dr. Lars Gule, he should educate his humanists, because the humanists, they were coming up with things that was an outdated cliche. I think from now on, Muslims should only talk to the wider society about Sharia if they've bothered to pick up and read a book about Sharia, because everything they go to is the news. We don't go to the news to judge people, we go to the literature. So my point is, stop the cartoons and let's connect with each other as human beings to find out, what do you mean by this? Jazakallah khair.
Thank you very much, Hamza, for your great answer. Next question would still be from the brother's side, but that would be for... Or is it from the sister's side now? I'm forgetting. Sister's side, right. Is it? For Dr. Lars Gule. 2 questions for the sisters.
Is this for Lars Gule? I can. This is a question that is directed to Lars Gule on behalf of his sister named Ayan. She says that, why do you define this assembly of men and women, both Muslims and non-Muslims, as for the women's side, as oppression? Have you ever spoke to any of the sisters? Why do you say that just because it contradicts with your point of view and your culture and your belief?
Bluntly put, there were slaves who accepted slavery. The fact that many women says that it says so in the Quran and therefore it's right, does not make it right. And there are hundreds and thousands and millions of Muslim women who are struggling against the segregation that you are practicing here today. That is the basis on which I condemn this kind of segregation. Because this is used to legitimize the next step. Go home, make children, don't get an education, be silent. And if you think this is just ha ha ha, then I will object also to Hamza's quite incredible distortion when he says that there are abuses of women, battering of women in the West. Yes, and we are trying to face that problem. We are increasing the penalties for men who batter women. We are trying to create and run shelters. In the Muslim world, to even talk about it is to ruin the family. If you cannot beat your woman, you are no longer a man. And you think this is ha-ha, as if there isn't beating of women? How many of you have been beaten? You are, either you are ignorant or you are lying. It is as simple as that. Either you are ignorant or you are lying, because then you have no idea who the women are filling up the Norwegian women's shelters today. The majority of the women in Norwegian shelters here in Oslo are Muslim women. And in Muslim countries where you allegedly should be following Islam out of fear of the punishment after death, battering of women is worse than in our part of the world. And if you don't believe me, then you really need to look carefully at your own countries and your own culture, because this is what is happening. And this is no laughing matter. This is actually very serious. How many honor killings? And if you are to... When the Queen in Jordan tried to change and institute punishment for the honor killings, what did the Muslim Brotherhood in Jordan say? It's against our tradition and our religion. You cannot accept, you cannot expect a man to accept that women, wives and daughters are behaving immorally without the man reacting. And if he kills them, we have to understand and excuse it. This is an example of the battering, the violence against women that is a consequence of this segregation. Because you think you are liberated, free, you have chosen, and many of you have chosen to wear the hijab, to be practicing believing Muslim women, and you have every right to do so. Of course you have. And we should all defend that right. But if you forget the history of the segregation you are practicing here and the consequences of that segregation in other countries, then you are either ignorant or you are lying, deceiving yourselves.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lars Gule, for your answer. Do we have a question for Hamza over here? One question for Hamza.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. My name is Jamshed. I'm with Aira, and I am a Muslim. I came to Islam through rational means, so my question is actually for Hamza. Sorry. In Dr. Lars' presentation, he mentioned that we shouldn't actually be surprised that we're here because we're here. And I'm curious that if that doesn't undermine your entire argument about the creation design, that the universe exists, you know, the whole universe exists by design. So doesn't that falsify that whole thing?
Thank you very much.
That's a very good question. I was going to leave that to my rebuttals at the end, but he's given me the opportunity to undermine the whole of Dr. Lars' argument against the argument for design. Now, Dr. Lars said that we shouldn't be surprised that we have fine-tuning for our existence because we're here to see that we're existing because of the fine-tuning. This is called the anthropic principle, and I think his misplaced the argument because the anthropic principle does say we shouldn't be surprised that we're here because we're here. Of course not, we shouldn't be surprised that we're here because we're here. But you cannot infer, you cannot make the inference, you cannot make the conclusion that we shouldn't be surprised because that there is fine-tuning for the universe. Let me give you an example. Say all of you were trained marksmen. You're all trained to fire a gun from 200 meters away. And you have lasers pointing to my head, every single one of you. And after three, one, two, three, I'm not dead. But the thing is, I shouldn't be surprised that I'm not dead because I'm not dead, right? Because I'm alive. But I should be surprised that the reason I'm not dead is because you all missed. Do you see the point? It's a subtle way to undermine the argument. He didn't understand the argument. The anthropic principle doesn't deny the fine-tuning. We're saying, yes, we're here, we're not surprised. But we should be surprised because the reason we're here is because of fine-tuning, just like the example with the marksman. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Can we have the next question from the brother's side to Dr. Lars Gule?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jeg heter Milad, jeg student ved Universitetet I Agder, og har et spørsmål til Lars Gule. Sier du at alle mennesker som har levd gjennom tiden, altså fra Adam og Eva til de 6,5 milliarder mennesker som bor på jordkloden I dag, at de tar feil ved å tro på noe overnaturlig eller tro på noe? Altså det finnes 2 milliarder katolikker, 2 milliarder muslimer og mange millioner hinduismer og buddhister I verden I dag, sier du at de tar feil, at du har riktig, og noen millioner kanskje som ateister?
I will just repeat that question in English briefly because we have viewers watching online as well, and maybe not everybody understands English here. The brother's question was briefly, that do you, Dr. Lars Gule, believe that all the human beings from the beginning of time that have believed in God, Christians, Jews, Hindus, Buddhists, Muslims, whatever religion, are wrong? And basically, what do you base that on, if I understood it correctly? Was that correct?
Yes.
Okay, fantastic.
Yes, I believe that they were and are wrong. Of course. I mean, that's what I have stated here. So that goes without, I mean, I have given the explanation for that. The interesting question is, have all those people throughout the ages really believed in God? What do we know about that? Actually, we do know a little bit. Atheists have been around for a long time. They have been there since times immemorial. They, as soon as people started believing in the gods, there were people there to reject the gods. So atheists, non-believers, have been around all along. And you have had people with strong faith, you had fundamentalists around also for a long time. And you have had weak believers, and you have had those who said, well, maybe, I don't know. Agnostics, we would call them today. You have had all sorts. The important thing here is that those who have had a strong, developed faith, they have been the politically dominant within society, and that's why they have left such great marks. I can't resist but to return to surprised or not surprised at humankind being here, existing at all. Now, this so-called anthropocentric principle, the fact that, well, if it had been a little bit different at Big Bang, we wouldn't have been here. That's fine. We are here. So then we know that the conditions at Big Bang were correct for us to appear 13 billion years later. It's as simple as that. When you start to use language like fine-tuning, then you imply a fine-tuner. Then you are saying someone meant us to be there. But that's what we have no reason to believe. That's just an assumption. And that's why you project backward a fine-tuner, and then you talk about the anthropocentric principle. The principle as such doesn't mean anything than that the conditions were right at a given time in a causal sequence. That's what it means. And out of it came we. It's when you are starting to use this principle, alleged principle, to say that, well, then someone must have adjusted these variables and constants to exactly the right levels and sizes. And then you are smuggling in God through the back door and say, aha, a fine-tuner equals God, which is really spurious way of arguing.
Thank you very much. I've heard that there is no questions on the sister side, so we will continue on the brother side. Yeah, please. Next question is for Hamza, right? Yes, fantastic.
My question is about the cause and the Quran. When you rhetorically led us through the deduction of where what causes the world and the cause of the cause and the cause, you said we have to choose that there is a first cause because the infinity of it makes us assume that we take the easiest one. How come not to take the easiest one, which is there is no cause? How come do I stop there and say, well, let's take the first cause as the easiest one out of the number of infinity? And this relates to the third argument. I could not see how you made the jump, logical jump in deduction, from the cause being God, being Allah. Because I can use that cause to be Buddha or any other creator. So how come the Quran? And if you allow me just 5 seconds.
You can take the next question in the... Go back in the queue and take, because you are already asked 2 questions in there. So the next question in the next time.
For him also.
Yeah, sure, but the next question you have to take in the next round. Thank you very much for your questions.
I'd like to thank the lady, I didn't catch her name, but I know it's Dr. Lars's wife, and I applaud that she's here today. It's very good that she's come to... It's good that she's come to support her husband, as there's a British saying that says, behind every successful man, there is a successful woman. Maybe that's not in line with his liberal humanist values, because when men, women's not supposed to be behind the men, but that's a different story. Anyway, very good question about the cause of the universe. So we're saying that if the universe began at a point, it either must be self-created, it created itself, it was created by something else, or created from nothing. All these, some of these options are absurd. For example, it can't create itself, because how can you exist and not exist at the same time? Also, if it came from nothing, that's an absurdity, and Dr. Lars Gule thought, well, we don't have any proof that things can come from nothing or can't come from nothing. I think that's, again, that's a slight philosophical play.
This term, can it come from nothing? This statement is not only innate, which in philosophy is a priori, we need the concept of causality to understand our reality, but also it's empirical. Because I want to challenge everybody, have you ever seen something come from nothing? It's empirical, because all the empirical evidence says that when you hear a noise, you know it came from somewhere. So the point is, for him to claim, well, we don't really know, is, again, the humanists and the atheists clutching at straws, trying to get out of the big hole they've made for themselves. And frankly, it's also an empirical point. Now, coming back to your question, what is more plausible? The Professor Anthony Flew, in his book, There Is a God, he made an amazing point. He said, look, either the cause of the universe is uncaused, or the universe is uncaused. Shall we take our pick? Let's take our pick. Do we have any evidence to believe the universe is caused? Of course, because it began to exist, because it came at a point in time. Cosmology, the Big Bang, even philosophically, if the universe was uncaused, it means it's eternal. It means the history of past events of the universe are infinite, and the infinite can't be brought into the real material world. It leads to absurdities. So we have so much good evidence to believe that we can never claim the universe is uncaused, because all the evidence, philosophical, mathematical, and cosmological, indicates that the universe began. So we have more evidence to believe that the universe is the thing that's caused, based upon that approach. The other thing you asked was about the logical jump from the cause to Allah. I think maybe you weren't attentive during the argument. When I talked about the first two arguments, or the first argument, the argument from creation, I said, we know there's a cause, a creator. We can never say it's Allah. I even said with my own words, we can't claim it's Jesus. We can't claim it's Buddha. We can't claim it's Allah. We can't claim any of the 3,800 names for God since 6 hours. Okay, the penny's dropped. You got it, right? Good. So the point I'm trying to say is, upon conceptual analysis, upon using our reason, as the Quran says, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ, use your brain. When we use our brain, our mind, our reasoning, upon the essential attributes of this creator cause, we do conceptual analysis and we come to the conclusion, as I said in my presentation, it must be one, must be uncaused, must be eternal, must be personal, and I gave all evidence for that. Unfortunately, you probably missed it out, but you've been nodding your head, so hopefully you remembered what I said.
Thank you. I remember what you said, but logical deduction alone does not lead me to God, Allah. Because if it's one, uncaused, it still can be named anything else. Why Allah?
Yes, I agree. What we did, let me tell you what we did, if you remember, then I took all the attributes, one, eternal, uncaused, and linked it to the basic definition as mentioned in the Quran itself. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, uniquely one. Allahu samad, eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad, he didn't beget nor was he begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, he's immaterial, transcendent. We took what reason gave us, the Quran said exactly the same thing.
Okay, now you've given me the entrance. You've jumped into the third point, the Quran. You're using the Quran as a justification for your deduction that was not really leading to God.
If okay, I see your point.
If I see a sonnet, the surah that you just recited, yes, one, God. But you've used the Quran. I want to reach to the Allah before I reach the Quran.
Okay, this is precisely the point. What you have to understand is that we didn't reach to the Quran. Remember, we did the conceptual analysis. We found out what the essential attributes are, and then because we're justifying the existence of God, and in the Islamic tradition it's Allah, does our reason correspond to what the Quran says? I never started with the Quran, then ended with reason. I started with reason, then ended with the Quran. Jazakallah khair.
Thank you very much for your very good questions, and thank you very much for your answers. The next question is for Dr. Lars Gule, but first I will ask, is there any question from the sister side to Dr. Lars Gule on the topic God, fairy tale, or truth? Okay, then the question comes to the brother.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My question is to Dr. Lars Gule. He said the universe created itself. Let's say for the moment it created itself. And we mankind exist on it. But who were the first mankind on the universe? Because if there was no creator, me, I know that I got a father and a mother, and my father got a mother and a father, where they came from. So who were the first mankind to be on the universe?
Well, this question also relates to what Hamza has said, that nothing comes from nothing. So there needs to be a creator. But what about God? Oh, God comes from nothing, or God is eternal. God, then you have used wordplay. Then you have simply used wordplay to make a definition of God that says that it is the uncaused cause. As a philosopher, as a science, with a scientific approach to reality, there is nothing wrong in saying with equal logical force that the universe caused itself, created itself. There is absolutely no way that you can say that it is wrong. And science is presenting answers to how that could be done. That is what modern cosmology is all about. Do they have an answer? Yeah, they have some. Are they satisfactory? To some. And to other scientists, they're not satisfactory. Are they difficult to understand? Oh, yes, indeed. Much more difficult to understand than the concept of God and the creator God. But the point here is that we are still investigating. These are questions that can be researched. They can be investigated. They can eventually be formulated in ways that will make it possible for us to test them. Then we can conduct experiments. And then we will say, well, no, there is something wrong here. Okay, we have a new generation of scientists and they will look for new answers. This is science. Science never ends. Science continues to look for even better answers. When you say it's God, you have found the final answer. There is nothing more to talk about. Read the Quran and you know everything. Sorry, it doesn't work like that. And if it was that the Quran revealed the inner workings of the cells of semen and the female egg and contraception, why didn't Muslims understand this so much better than everybody else? And actually advanced science in this regard. Why is it that you always say, oh, now we can see how far advanced the Quran was? Why didn't they understand that 100 years ago? Why didn't they see that here? Look, scientists in Europe at the universities, look here and here. Put your microscope here and do what the Quran says. There wasn't a Muslim scientist who said that. You have hundreds of prophets who have made the most strange and interesting and ludicrous and wonderful prophecies. And then afterwards, oh, see how right he was. And then another 100 years, see how totally wrong he was. These kinds of arguments, you look back, you put it into an already established frame of interpretation. This is apologetics. Has nothing to do with scientific or logical proof for God. On the contrary, you are showing how futile the exercise of proving the existence of God is by using the Quran the way Hamza has done here today.
As I've understood, thank you very much, Dr. Lars Gule. As I've understood, we have a sister with a question, but is that for Hamza or for Dr. Lars Gule? Okay, no question. Do we have a question for Hamza on the topic God, fairy tale, or truth?
Before I ask the question, I need some support from the sisters to provide evidence to validate my question. If the camera can turn towards the sisters, please. Sisters, I'll ask you three questions to clarify the picture. Some points were raised by Dr. Gula. And I want an answer collectively from you. Are you oppressed to be Muslims?
No!
Did anyone force you to wear hijab?
No.
Would you give up Islam for anything?
No.
Okay, this is the miracle of Islam. Last 10 seconds, my question to Hamza. Hamza, can you substantiate my point about the rights of woman being a miracle for Islam and a sign for the existence of God? Thank you.
Thank you very much for your beautiful question. But as the chairman, I must say that please make it within 40 seconds.
Okay, that's a very good question, and thank you, sisters. Jazakallah khair. Basically, first of all, I'd like to make a point about apologetics. I think the one who sounds like a man full of faith, like a man who's a religious fanatic, is Dr. Gule today. Because he says, the cosmologists are giving us answers. We just have to pray and wait for them. This is what he's saying. The scientists have the answers. I don't know what they are, but I believe in them. Doesn't that sound like a religious fanatic to you? Honestly, I mean, I am totally shocked. I'm bedazzled. I'm flabbergasted. I am shocked at the level of approach that you've taken to this debate. You offended women, nothing to do with God. You offended other things, nothing to do with God. You repeat the argument which I refuted even in the beginning of my presentation about who caused God, and you say things like, oh, then how did God come to be? Well, your statement is fallacious. We even said God never came to be, so the question doesn't apply. And also, by rational necessity, must be uncaused, because I gave the example of giving you a kiss. Do you want that kiss or something? So, the point I'm trying to say is, yes, Adnan, thank you very much. I think with regards to the women pre-Islamic Arabia, there used to be a flag on a woman's tent when any man could go inside and sleep with her. Something that's very similar to liberal Western society with prostitution. There's 80,000 prostitutes in England. The government are doing nothing about it. Islam honors the woman and says, we're going to stop this and we have to honor the woman. And that's the reality of Islam. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the best of you in faith are the ones who are best to their wives. Do we hear this from David Cameron and Obama? We don't hear none of this. We don't hear none of this. What about economic rights? Women don't even have to work because we honor the woman, we elevate her. She doesn't even have to. She doesn't even have to pay for her house. We have to provide. If the man can provide, the government will provide. She doesn't even have to pay for an education. The husband or uncle, the one who's a wali in charge of her affairs, has to and is obligated to pay for her education. She doesn't have to pay for her own makeup. That's the reality in Islam. And I ask you the question, in which liberal society do we have, is David Cameron giving money to the homeless women? 50 to 80,000 homeless people in England. Where is the money? The bankers get away with everything, but we can't take the money from the bankers who even stole our own taxes to provide and honor the women and families. This is the reality of individualism, which is the basis of your society, which is liberalism. I would challenge anybody today. I would even make sure that we're here until 1 a.m, I'll debate on liberalism and show how individualism is the most disgusting thing that came in this society because it caused excessive greed. What's happening in Somalia? There's 10 million people starving because of food. But we have 10 million people dying because of obesity, fat chips, KFC, chicken, pizzas in America. They're dying of too much food, but in Somalia they're dying of no food. It's nothing to do with too many needs and not enough resources. That's an outdated geopolitical myth. The reality is the distribution of resources. Who solved that problem? Zakah, sadaqah.
academic is. Now, Dr. Lars Gule may say, well, we disagree with this. We want to elevate people. We want to change the society. That's why Western society is making more harsh punishments. That's not true. In the UK, there was a huge debate because the guys, the politicians, the corrupt people, they wanted to lower the crime for rape. They wanted to lower the crime for rape in UK just early this year. And he might say, well, humanism has the solutions. It doesn't. You know why? Because it's based on social consensus. And what does that do? The ones with the most money and power will make the most influence, like we see in capitalist societies. This is why children in England have UK riots, because they have no purpose in life. What defines them is their bling bling, their trainers, and their mobile phone. They don't have it, they don't have a definition, they don't have identity, therefore they have to steal it. He might say, well, humanism is gonna solve the problem. It won't, because you're calling for the solution, which is the thing that caused the problem in the first place, which is individualism. SubhanAllah.
JazakAllah khair. Thank you very much, Hamza, for your great answer. Now the next question is for Dr. Lars Gule on the topic God, fairy tale, or truth.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Majid. I'm a student. In the speech, in the first, you told that in the Quran it's mentioned that the earth was flat, and you've probably read the Quran, so can you tell me where you found that statement or surah?
That was probably an exaggeration, so I should make an apology for having said that. But I won't, because it seems to be correct. So the general point here is that there is a lot said in the Quran that is disproved by modern science. And you cannot pick and choose and say that the Quran proves science on the one hand and then ignore all the other examples that does not fit with modern science. And those of you who read the Quran can look for yourself. I do not spend much time on looking at the Quran.
But can you mention some examples?
Yes, now I've been challenged. So I will go and find those things and I can post them on, you know. But you are a reader of the Quran. You know, it's very interesting. There is some parts of the Bible I studied. And it's very interesting to hear Christians say, this and this and this is in the Bible. Yes, because I've read it. And I say, well, this and this is also in the Bible. And I say, no, I never read that. Well, go and look. And it's there. And what I'm saying is also there. I am not a Hafiz. I have never memorized the Quran. We have other people here. Now, what kind of miracle, in view of women's rights, do the Quran represent? An increase of women's rights according to certain practices in the Arab Peninsula at the time of Muhammad? Probably, but not necessarily quite that simple. And the question remains, and this is, and I am also amazed at the level of rhetoric. If I am accused of being a religious fanatic here, what then is Hamza with his level of rhetoric, who has consistently avoided the challenge of explaining why Islam is not practiced by Muslims? Why is women oppressed? You are saying that you are free, and there are millions of Muslim women who are saying they are oppressed. They are in Pakistan, they're in Bangladesh, they're in Saudi Arabia, they are in Syria, they are in Palestine, they are in Jordan, they are in Morocco, they are in Algeria, they're in the Sudan. You find them all over the Muslim world. Millions of women who, when asked, will tell you that they are oppressed. Not allowed to do this and that. And then he comes with, oh, we exalt the woman. To be exalted means that you respect
people's inherent dignity and their right to choose for themselves. And this is what is lacking in so many Muslim countries. Finally, and trying to get back to the question of God, fairy tale or truth. Now, is the question, who created or what created God, a meaningful question? Is it a question that, well, yes, we can reflect on that question? Is it a question that has an answer? Yes, Hamza has answered it, and he says, it's a question that has the answer that God was not created because God exists from eternity to eternity. Fine, it's an answer. It's not an answer I like or accept. But the point is that you can give the same answer about the universe, that it created itself or existed from eternity. Well, it necessarily did, because modern cosmology, in some varieties, says that it was nothing before the universe came into being. That it was nothing, not even God. So, to say that by definition, God is exempt from being scrutinized as what caused God is a cop-out that is no better, actually it's quite worse than, because it's wordplay, than saying that we have a universe that came into existence from nothing.
Thank you very much for your answer. The next question is for Hamza, and it may be the last question, we'll see.
My question is, the doctor mentioned that this universe created itself, and in another occasion he mentioned other possible universes. Does this have any scientific or rational basis?
Okay, thank you very much.
First and foremost, I want to clarify this issue about the earth being flat. In the Quran, never says the earth being flat. If we do a very careful linguistic analysis, there's a concept in linguistics called co-text. It's a Western and Eastern phenomena where you see a word in context of the surrounding word and you understand the beauty of the language. For example, the Quran mentions earth in various places in various ways and also says the earth has been spread with regards to a lot of places on the earth are flat for us to be able to walk on. But with specific regard of the earth is round, the Quran says in chapter 39, verse 5, He created the universe, the heavens and the earth for truth. He wraps the night in the day and wraps the day in the night. The word here in Arabic to wrap is takwir. And takwir means, if you go to the classical dictionaries, you see the wrapping of a turban. Does that indicate the roundness of the earth to you or the flatness of the earth? Anyway, the point about the createness, did God get created again? You're making a big hole for yourself. The point is this, I agree it was a question, I gave an answer, and the answers were, God never began to exist. The answers were, by rational necessity there must be uncaused cause because of the absurdity of infinite regress. You have to answer the question because we got so much philosophical, mathematical, cosmological, scientific, and physical evidence to show that the universe began to exist. You are trying to say to the audience, you're talking about magic and conspiracy. Everybody, when things begin to exist, they never have a cause. Can we believe such a thing? Let's have a show of hands. I know you don't want to play by authority, but just for the taste of the day. Put your hands up if you believe, if something begins to exist, never has a cause. Your wife has to back you up, I guess. Now, just to make this much better, just to be on the side of the atheist, because I don't think he's doing a very good job for the atheist, by the way. Because let me try and be an atheist. I'm going to put my atheist hat on. If I was an atheist, I would have said, you know what? In quantum mechanics, there are subatomic events that come into the vacuum without any corresponding causes. So things can come into being without any causes. That is a valid argument in physics, but we could refute it as well, because the vacuum is not nothing. It's a sea of fluctuating energy. Many physicists are adopting a deterministic approach, saying these events actually do have causes. So I could even sit here and argue with myself, because he's not doing a very good job. But
with regards to, it could have been multi-universes, we could have came from another set of universes. Well, the question is, we have to explain those universes. If they're a multi-universe, an infinite set of universes, first and foremost, you can't have an infinite regress, that doesn't make sense. The multiverse, in the words of the philosopher of science, John Polkinghorne, he said the multiverse theory is a religious theory. It has no physical evidence. It's just metaphysics. It's just philosophical mumbo jumbo. It's just something that some of the scientists have adopted to move God out of the question. Let's push him away for a bit. Let's push him away for a bit. So in the multiverse theory also doesn't make sense, because for multiverses to come into being requires fine-tuning. Think about it. Multiverses to come into being require design and fine-tuning. So the multiverse approach, the who created God approach, is all fallacious. I hope I've explained it. Let's not go around in circles. Let's move the debate to something more useful, like talking about the existence of God, instead of politics. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your answer. According to our schedule, the time is really up. So what we're going to do, we're going to end the question and answer session right now, and then Dr. Lars Gule will have 10 minutes to give his final rebuttal, and then Hamza will have 10 minutes to give his final rebuttal, and then we will conclude with some formal conclusion. Dr. Lars Gule, your final 10 minutes. Please, some silence.
I think this is an important debate, philosophically speaking. It is a debate about the basis on our convictions, our worldviews, and therefore they have great bearing, as I've also tried to say in my introduction, bearing on our moral values, how we argue and how we represent these values. Therefore, what is seemingly a strange philosophical question without much practical use turns out to be of great importance when it comes to understanding how we, the next time around, and I expect that might be the next debate I'm invited for, is to argue about the basis of values. Well, a lot has been said, and more could be said, about modern cosmology. I will reiterate that, yes, we do have religious cosmologists, people who are searching for God in their cosmological theories. They are not searching for a personal Christian, Jewish, or Islamic God. They are searching for principles, abstractions behind the reasons why we are here. In the sense, not why someone intended it, because they will have to explain how we came to be here. Someone thinks that an explanation of how something came into being at the same time is an answer to the question why we are here. And there is a confusion of those two questions. Those who insist that we need to know why we are here has simply not understood what science is all about, because science is not about answering the question why. Science is about explaining how we came to be. Now, there is probably some important differences between logical infinite regresses and allegedly physical regresses. We don't know if a universe that was caused by the Big Bang had another cause before the Big Bang that caused another something. Modern cosmology opens for that possibility, and we are searching for a series of universes. And Hamza said, we don't know why the universe is expanding. Well, we do know something about it. What we don't know is if this expansion is going to go on forever, or if we will see contraction. That depends on questions we have asked but not been able to answer, which concerns the mass of the universe. If the universe has a certain mass, it will expand forever. If it has an other mass, it will start to contract, which might lead to a big black hole and perhaps the creation of a new universe. And perhaps our universe is the result of such a process. The point here is that the classical argument from creation or the need for a first cause and the argument from design are not arguments that will stand up to close scrutiny. They have been tested in Muslim versions, in Christian versions, and they have been refuted by much better philosophers and scientists than me. So I might do a poor job here today in defending my answer to this question. It doesn't mean that better answers does not exist, although you might not have heard the best arguments here tonight. Now, we could probably go on and argue about this. I think the fact that we had the argument and that this was the first in Norwegian history that a humanist atheist was invited to a very conservative, some would say fundamentalist, I would probably say Salafi, Muslim congregation, is in itself valuable. And the fact that we are able to meet, even in a harsh debate about these questions, and you think it's so important that you are live streaming it and will post it on your websites and YouTube, and I don't know where it will not end up eventually. Dare I travel back to the Middle East afterwards? Ooh. I think this is a valuable contribution to two things. Number one, the understanding between different life stances in Norway. This is extremely important. You have seen that an atheist can come and argue without biting your heads off. I have seen, and through the live transmission here and the publicity that this meeting has received and will receive, you have seen, or other Norwegians have seen, that it is absolutely possible to sit down and argue, even on the most basic and, for some, most important questions, the existence of God or not. That in itself is valuable. I don't think we can say that we have come to a final conclusion on the question, but the fact that we had the debate is something that I applaud and thank you for. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lars Gule. And we will have the last minutes by Hamza before we conclude. Thank you very much.
Brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to thank you all for your time and your patience. It's been a very interesting debate. I think if we learn anything from today's debate is that people can come together, because what happened, the disaster and the tragedy what happened in Oslo just a while ago was something that doesn't belong to secularism, that something doesn't belong to religion, it belongs to insanity. And we have shown, as human beings, we can connect with each other, even if it's a bit loud, even if it's a bit rhetorical, and even if it's a bit outdated. But the point is, we can come together and connect in this way, which is one of the good things about Norwegian societies. For that, please give yourselves a round of applause. This is why it's very important for us to do these things, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the cure to ignorance is to ask and learn. So this is why it was good you were asking, and we were trying to give some answers, and we also have questions ourselves that we want to develop further, maybe in a future debate in London. Yep, nice holiday.
Inshallah.
Inshallah, he says.
First and foremost, I'd like to really add that the first argument from the argument from creation was not refuted in any shape or form. When we spoke about that, the best explanation is that it must have been created with a creator with certain features that is one, eternal, unique, immaterial. This wasn't countered at all. The only counter argument we heard was, well, maybe the universe created itself. And we showed that this is a logical absurdity because something cannot exist and not exist at the same time. To even claim such a thing would be claiming an absurdity. Secondly, the counter argument was, well, who created God? And just earlier, we dealt with this. God never began to exist. The absurdity of infinite regress of causes, etc., etc. We showed this very clearly. Also, we talked about the design of the universe, that the fine-tuning of the universe is best explained, not by physical necessity, not by chance, by design. Dr. Lars Gule was claiming physical necessity. He never proved it. He never shown how physical necessity actually is the best explanation for fine-tuning. He just claimed it. And I went slowly with all the points. It can't be physical necessity because these values are not contingent, not dependent on the laws of nature. It can't be physical necessity because it would have us to believe that another universe that could never allow life could never exist, which is not true according to physics. Chance. He should have went to the chance hypothesis, a more strong hypothesis amongst his fellow religionists. Sorry, atheists. That was another joke. So, and he couldn't deal with that because the chance hypothesis is a ridiculous hypothesis. So the best inference, which is the best conclusion, reasoning to the best conclusion, is that it was designed. There was no counter argument in any shape or form for that. Then we talked about the Quran. We spoke about the historical miracle. No mention. Surprisingly, about the historical miracle of how could the Quran mention Malik and Fir'aun, of the two different titles of the leader of the Egyptians at two different times, which is accurate historically, but was never mentioned or even applied and implemented in that, at that time, 1400 years ago. Where did he get this knowledge from? Embryology. He came with the horse and the embryo and the dissections. Again, we mention things in the Quran that cannot be seen with the naked eye. The nutfa, from a male and a female. It's the zygote, according to modern embryologists. Also, we spoke about fakasona idham lahma. And we clothe the bones with flesh, the myoblasts, they migrate distally and form masses to form muscles over the cartilaginous models of the bones, something that cannot be seen with the naked eye. And also, he claimed that there was knowledge at the time. Galen got it wrong, Aristotle got it wrong. Galen said the semen, the sperm has the faculties and the woman has nothing. Aristotle said it's the menstrual blood with the semen that creates the baby, something absurd. Also, Aristotle claimed about where the embryo is going to be in the womb, then you know if it's going to be a male or a female. The Galen, Aristotle never mentioned the process of clothing the bones, never mentioned the process of the secure place, the implantation after the sixth or seventh day in the development of the human embryo, all which can't be seen with the naked eye. This is why he should have been a bit more honest and said, Hamza, I don't know. And that would have been the best, more honest position, rather than saying, go to the internet, read it yourself. So none of these arguments has been refuted. Also, we have more arguments for the Quran. The Quran says in chapter 25, verse 61, blessed is he, Allah, who placed the heaven, the big stars, and has placed them in a great lamp and a moon giving light. We know that the lamp here means the sun is a giving light and the moon is a borrowed light, because we know the light from the moon is actually reflected from the sun. The Quran mentioned this 1400 years ago. The Quran mentions that we made from every living thing water. Will they not believe? And every living thing is made of water. Every chemical biological process needs water in an aqueous type of solution. Also, we have other evidence for the Quran. When the Quran mentions about mountains, the Quran says, have we not made the earth as a bed and the mountains as its pegs? The geologists actually mention the roots of the mountains. They actually mention these real words, the roots. And the Arabic word here in this verse is autad, the plural of watad, which means to drive a ram firmly, to fix and fasten and secure. And these pegs or stakes are driven into the ground, similar and anchored to a tent in the deep foundations of the geological folds. And also the Quran says,
lest it shift with you and made rivers and roads that you may be guided, which shows that these things are to create stability, which is the concept of isostasis, which is something that the Islamic Education Research Academy is actually going to develop further and refute some of the online claims by the atheists. But I want to end, brothers and sisters, by saying this. The Quran has the final say in a very eloquent way. The Quran says in chapter 78, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أما يتساءلون عن النبأ العظيم الذي هم فيه مختلفون كلا سيعلمون ثم كلا سيعلمون. Quran says concerning about what they're disputing, concerning the great news about that which they cannot agree, verily they will come to know. Verily, indeed, then they will come to know. The Quran has the final say, because the Quran is the miraculous discourse that hasn't been challenged for 1400 years. The Quran is a miracle of miracles. It transcends even the scientific miracle. As the Quran says in Surah Baqarah verse 23, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبِ مِمَّا نَزَلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. The Mufassirun, those who explain the Quran, said this is a linguistic miracle of the Quran. And the Quran indeed is a linguistic miracle. It produces and expresses itself in an Arabic language that is a unique literary form. It's not about subjective, oh, I like it or I don't. It's about the mechanics of the language. It's a unique literary form. As A.J. Arbery said, the famous Orientalist, the Quran is neither prose nor poetry, but a unique fusion of both. Professor Bruce Lawrence from Duke University, in his book, The Quran, a biography on page 8, says the Quranic verses as tangible signs are expressive of inexhaustible truth. They signify meaning laid within meaning, light upon light, miracle after miracle. Reverend R. Boswell Smith, in his book, Muhammad and Muhammadanism, says the Quran is of miracle of purity of style. It is of wisdom and of truth. It is one miracle claimed by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and a miracle indeed it is. Dr. Martin Zamet from the Netherlands, he said the Quran is the most eminent written manifestation of the Arabic language. What else do we need to know? This is the reality. A desert Arab who knew, he was unlettered. He was unlettered, unlearned in these sciences. Start blazing within unique language. How can we explain the civilization of Islam? One man, one book, 23 years and you have a civilization. Unheard of anthropologically, unheard of historically. And it's because of this that the Orientalists came with bizarre claims saying that the Prophet was a super genius or he was a superman. I'd rather believe in God than believe in a superman. Superman wears red underpants over his trousers. And finally, we have to realize, although this was a talk about God's existence, which I think we dealt with very nicely, we know that Islamic civilization is here to make good humanity. Quran says, "Ukhrijat linnas," for the people, not from the people. Muslims should be a mercy. He claimed that in Pakistan, women are oppressed. Do you know why women are oppressed? Not because of Islam, because of an absence of Islam, because the colonial period, in the colonial period, when the British came along, one minute. When the British came and colonized these lands, they removed Islam as a reference point and put a mix match of colonial penal code, and that was the reference point, because women 100 years ago had no soul, they couldn't vote and they couldn't own their own property, but Islam gave that right from the very beginning 1400 years ago. The problem was Western domination, not Islamic domination. When Islam came in, when a woman was interrupted and hurt and she cried, "Help me," she cried, "Help me," in the other lands, I think in the Byzantine lands, the man, the sultan, the caliph, he knew the responsibility to the state was to protect women and honor them. And for one woman, he wrote a letter to the dog of Rome. And he said, "You're going to have an army that ends with me and starts with you, because you've troubled a woman." That's the honor we have for women. And brothers and sisters, friends, just to end, don't be arrogant with your tradition. Giving people the message of Islam doesn't mean that we're better than them. It means we just have something better for you. It never means we're better than them. The Muslim is humble and he shouldn't have any arrogance. On a final note, huge apologies. On a final note, The Quran, inshallah, if implemented in the Muslim lands, will have justice. What does the Quran say about justice? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُنُوا قَوَّمِينَ لِلَّهِ شُهَدَاءَ بِالْقِسْطِ وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ لَعَلَّ تَعْدِلُوا. O you who believe, be steadfast witnesses in God for justice. Do not let the hatred of others make you swerve away from justice. Be just, for that's closer to your duty to God. Allahu Akbar.
JazakAllah khair, Brother Hamza, for your final rebuttal. Before we end, I just have 2 more minutes I want you to stay for. Only 2 more minutes. Okay? Everyone, please just stay for 2 more minutes. That's it. I will use these 2 minutes to ask all our volunteers to come up there for the sisters and all the brothers that has been working with us, struggling and striving to make this event a reality, to come down, because we have some diplomas for you, because we want to show support, we want to show the people that we care about the people as well. So all our volunteers, please come down. Come on, come on, come on. I can see you all around. Please come down and stand in front of the stage. All of you who have been working here, please come down. It has been a great pleasure to have Dr. Lars Gule here with us for this fantastic debate. And we would definitely like to engage with Dr. Lars Gule again on more debates, on more topics. And it has also been a great pleasure to have Hamza Tzortzis come here to participate. And we will also like to have Hamza again. And we will also like to thank Brother Adnan Rashid for his beautiful lecture yesterday. And lastly, I would like to thank the audience who have made this event for what it is. If you were not here, then it would be quite boring for all of us. So give a round of applause for yourself. And those of you who are really inspired and would like to work with us, please just visit our website when you go home, www.islamnet.no, and click on the button that says Job Medawa, and inshallah get engaged with us. Thank you all for having us here. JazakAllah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.